What really happened with your host, Mike Rivero? You're listening to the Republic Broadcasting Network, where you'll find out what the Fukushima's going on.
And aloha, America. Welcome to our show today. It is Friday, July 1st, 2016. Thank goodness it's Friday. Thank goodness it's Friday. We have a lot of stuff to talk about today. The phone lines are open, 800-313-9443. 800-313-9443. Mike is in our control room, twiddling the dials, keeping us out of trouble, ready to answer the phone when you call on in. We're live today, but a quick reminder, Monday is July 4th, and we're going to be giving our overworked and grossly underpaid staff the day off, and so it's all going to be replaced. But we'll be back live Tuesday on the 5th. Another little quick program note here, of course, in our third hour today, the lovely Lady Claire will be joining us with her unique perspective on the world. So getting right into the news here, first of all, I want to wish a happy birthday to all of our listeners up there in Canada. And happy celebrations there. And, of course, here in the U.S., we're coming up on effectively our birthday on the 4th. The signing of the Declaration of Independence. We'll be talking about that a little bit later in the show. And as is to be expected at this particular point, there's been another so-called terrorist attack. ISIS is taking credit. There's a hostage situation down there in Bangladesh. And apparently the gunman invaded a restaurant, actually a bakery, about a block from the U.S. Embassy. Feels more like they got lost than anything. And now there's a hostage situation, and the media's pounding on it, and thank goodness they've got something to talk about that isn't involved with Loretta Lynch and Hillary Clinton and the deterioration of that whole situation. So, again, they're really pushing terror again. All of a sudden, have you noticed they're asking, terror. They're trying to get us to forget that we know the U.S. government, the Obama administration, supported and aided ISIS and Al-Qaeda in Syria and have been protecting ISIS in Iraq. It's right out of George Orwell's 1984. The government makes the enemy they scare you with, so you will be obedient. Now, 21st Wire basically is celebrating or a moment of vindication, if you will. As you know, there earlier in the week, there was supposed to be this active shooter situation at Andrews Air Force Base where they keep Air Force One, and the media was all over it. And it turned out it was a drill, and it was only a drill, and the media somehow got involved thinking it was an actual real shooter situation because somebody inside the base dialed 911 rather than base security. So it looks like somebody was trying to crank up more news on this whole mad shooter, terrorist, keep everybody afraid so they'll do what they're told kind of situation. But they've really worn it out. You know, another one of these attacks and everybody says, you know, it's part of the background noise now. Now, the real interesting news that came out earlier today, and you have to be careful of the language here, but United States Attorney General Loretta Lynch has not actually recused herself from the Hillary Clinton investigations. She's saying she's going to step back. She was very embarrassed by that private meeting with Bill Clinton that was discovered out there, and she's out there saying it probably wasn't the smartest thing for her to be seen doing, and it wasn't. I don't think they intended to be seen. But she's going to step back now and allow non-political subordinates to make the decisions about indictments. And if you believe that one, I have some of Saddam's nuclear weapons to sell you. Now, the other issue, of course, is they're trying to spread the blame around now if there are no indictments. Oh, it wasn't Loretta Lynch. It was the subordinates and, you know, it was FBI Director Comey. And we know, again, the FBI has been the Clintons' protector going all the way back to the murder of White House Deputy Counsel Vincent Foster. And Hillary can blackmail them with that, so I'm not expecting anything to come out of Director Comey at this point. Okay, now, interesting little article that came on out at Government Slaves asking if Bill Clinton, in his meeting with Attorney General Loretta Lynch, was trying to come to some kind of a plea bargain, not so much for Hillary, but for himself, because along with the email and espionage and security investigation, there's a racketeering investigation into the Clinton Foundation. And from what we can see from the outside, there is plenty of pay dirt there. And it is rather interesting that right after the meeting, the Department of Justice said that they were going to withhold all of the emails. Actually, the State Department said they were going to withhold all of the emails regarding the Clinton Foundation for 27 months. Now, I don't think that's the State Department's jurisdiction. They don't have anything to do with the Clinton Foundation. A case could be made they're engaging in obstruction of justice. And the foundation is the Clinton piggyback. And there's a lot of money gone in there, and nobody knows where it went. There was the big stink over all the money that was collected for Haiti following the earthquake and how little was done. For all that money that was donated, the Red Cross was able to build 6 homes. Just 6. That's all that was actually done. There's another scandal brewing, and this one is over at Fox News, no less. And it has to do with Hillary Clinton's son-in-law, Mark Mezvinsky, who set up a hedge fund betting on a Greek recovery and lost a fortune. And apparently some of the released emails from 2012 show that she and Clinton Foundation consultant Sidney Blumenthal were trying to get more information about what was going on inside Greece. And that information was shared with Bill Clinton. And where it went from there, we don't know. Now, we're going to take a moment here to welcome our on-air guests, on-air affiliates, rather, back to our network. And also, I was asked to give a shout-out to Lori in Sun City, Arizona. So, hello, Lori. And we're going to go ahead and grab a phone call from Illegal in Texas. Aloha. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Hello. Oh, I was just calling to say, you know, you touched the subject of guns being sent to the cartel from Mexico.
Yes.
And I thought maybe, you know, to be fair, that might be one of the reasons why we get such a big wave of illegals over here.
I think the reason we've got the wave of illegals, I mean, Mexicans, nationals have been trying to come to this country, you know, for decades and decades and decades. We used to have secure, strong borders, you know, Eisenhower's Operation
right.
Wetback and so forth. The reason there's a huge flood of them now is Obama has opened the borders to illegal immigrants from Mexico, Central America, South America, refugees from the Middle East. They're being let in without any vetting whatsoever, not even a health check. And they're the potential for terrorists sneaking in through this pathway is obvious, and they are introducing contagious diseases to the United States that had been eradicated in times past.
And I'm not arguing that point. It is true that the U.S. is getting an influx of immigrants, and they aren't being tested, and they're not going through the proper procedure to get here. My only point was there are certain things that the U.S. has done that may have caused that. You know what I'm saying? Like the fact that you said Fast and the Furious delivered so many guns to the cartels. Those cartels down there, they're just killing innocent people. They upload videos on Lively where they have little kids and they ask them all sorts of questions, and then they execute them. They chop them into pieces. So the horror that's being produced by certain actions can lead to some people wanting to leave their homes because of that.
Well, I'm sure it's a contributing factor. I mean, the quality of life in Mexico continues to decline as the drug cartels gain power, and here you have the U.S. government giving these guys military weapons, and the only logical conclusion is that the U.S. government is helping one cartel establish a monopoly in order to increase drug profits, because if there's no competition, they can raise the prices on the drugs.
Correct. And I also wanted to point one more thing out. I like your show. I like listening to it. This is coming from an illegal immigrant's point of view. It's pretty good. And this is 4th of July weekend. I think all federal workers are off, right?
They're off on Monday. I think they're supposed to be working today.
Well, if they're off on Monday, I think we have nothing to worry about ISIS, considering their federal agency. Right?
I don't know. I think they put those agent provocateurs on double and triple time to get them to work on holidays. I'm more worried about the U.S. hauling off and invading Syria while we're all busy with our party poppers and our hot dogs on Monday.
True. Well, thanks a lot for taking my call.
Thank you very much for the phone call. We're going to let you go here. Now, getting on back to Clinton and corruption and Loretta Lynch, what's really interesting is over in New York at 1 Pierpont Plaza in Brooklyn, it's a lovely modern building, and Hillary Clinton's campaign headquarters is located there just two floors below the New York offices of Attorney General Loretta Lynch. Gee, think maybe they got to go out to lunch every now and then, talk about how to protect Hillary Clinton from what she's been doing. And there's yet another revelation. George Stephanopoulos, who is over at ABC as the chief anchor, has donated $75,000 to the Clinton Foundation in recent years, and he has not disclosed that while he reports on ABC News on the Clintons. Very obviously, he is pro-Clinton. He's not revealing that bias. He's reporting his bias as if it's absolute fact. But again, that's one of the reasons why the viewership of the corporate news media is in such serious trouble right now. And there's been another development regarding Hillary's weak email server. And it has to do with the company that was doing the backups. Now remember, Bill Clinton, when he was president, signed an executive order requiring that any outside computer companies working on any computers that might contain U.S. secrets had to pass security checks by U.S. intelligence agencies. The company that was maintaining Hillary's homebrew email server never did, and neither did this company. And the Daily Mail is reporting that this second company that was hired to keep a backup of Clinton's server was so lax in its security, employees failed to change passwords frequently, left computer terminals logged in unattended. Clients were able to see each other's data. And again, it's another point of vulnerability for people to hack on in and grab America's secrets for free or at a discounted price. Now, Hillary's been caught in another lie under oath, because when she was testifying before Congress about Benghazi back in October 2015, Hillary Clinton told the Benghazi committee she checked in on all the government personnel who'd been injured during the attack at the consulate, saying that she had talked to all the survivors when they came back to the United States. Turns out it was a flat-out lie. She only ever spoke with one gentleman who was seriously injured, was in the hospital for almost a year, and it took Hillary 48 days even to do that. Now, I'll grant you it's a small lie, but it underscores the fact that Hillary just lies about everything. Hillary Clinton is still out there vowing to prosecute all global warming deniers. You know, if you're denying human-caused global warming, Hillary's going to get you. Loretta Lynch is going to prosecute you. All right. There was a video apparently up in Sacramento. There was a political rally, and there was a guy who was protesting against Hillary Clinton, and the mob just body slammed him, threw him to the ground. The Sacramento police did nothing whatsoever. This is brown shirt tactics. Right out of Nazi Germany and Hitler's seizing of power. Now, apparently, there's yet another election fraud and voter suppression lawsuit being launched. This one literally nationwide. Because there have been so many problems uncovered during the primary season. They weren't even trying to hide the fraud in some cases. And there is a new movement out there to basically get a recount on all the primaries, because people are convinced that Bernie Sanders actually did win a lot of these primaries, and they were stolen from him, especially in California, where there are already two other lawsuits on this issue. And they're calling the movement Bernie Strong and Bernie Mobilized. Those are the hashtags. And here is a legal precedent that may have a bearing. Now, remember back in that debacle in Florida in 2000, where the Supreme Court basically came on out and handed the presidency to George Bush and then said there is no remedy for all the documented election fraud in Florida, And by the way, you can't use this decision as precedent for anything in the future, which was history-making for the Supreme Court. Well, there's a new precedent, because over in Austria, their highest court has canceled their recent presidential election completely because of fraud detected with the absentee vote count, and they're ordering a complete redo of the election. And we need to start doing that here with all these questionable primaries. Austria has set the precedent. Yes, you can order a do-over on an election that appears to be crooked. And we need to start doing that. Now, Donald Trump is out there on the campaign trail. And one of the people that he's got up on the podium with him is one of the many, many, too many American workers who, after decades of service to the companies they work for, are ordered to train their foreign-born replacements and then given the pink slip. And it's happened a lot of places. It's happened a lot in high tech, happened at Disneyland. People are angry about that. None of the other candidates out there. Well, by at this point, it's down to Hillary. Hillary won't talk about this. She won't mention it. Now, as long as we're on the subject of pushing that terror idea, apparently there was a terrorist attack on a humanitarian convoy in Syria by a group that the UN wanted to put on the terror watch list a long time ago. And the U.S. refused and blocked and said this group is part of the Syrian political process. They do a lot of work for Saudi Arabia. We're going to veto. So we now have this terrorist group that's attacking a humanitarian aid convoy being protected from being on the terror watch lists by the U.S. government. And you have to start asking that question. Whose side is this government on? Now, Putin is taking the initiative to try and defuse this rush to a new world war. And he's basically come on out and said it's time for Moscow to start a dialogue with NATO and try and settle things down despite the recent expansionism toward Russia's border. Putin is refusing to rattle his saber. Now, probably a lot of the pro-war on Russia people are thinking that Putin has blinked. I don't see it that way. Putin is proving once again that he is after peace, and he's being a statesman, as opposed to the U.S. government, which is still apparently convinced a new world war is going to solve all their self-created problems. Another story coming out of Russia today. Sanctions are evidence of the intellectual bankruptcy of Merkel's Russia policy. And they're basically talking about how this idea of sanctions, it's a form of economic war, and it's caused much more damage to Europe and the United States and other places around the world than it did to Russia. And they're still pushing that, because if it's failing, let's just keep on going and hope there's going to be a change. Now, getting on down to Great Britain and the Brexit, there's a couple of new developments. Phony Tony Blair, who's very pro-Euro, is trying to worm his way into being the chief negotiator for the Brexit. And he's not too surprisingly meeting a lot of opposition, but he's trying to get in there to be the negotiator who arranges or sabotages Britain's exit from the European Union. Now, the British Home Secretary is saying that they will not invoke Article 50 on the Brexit anytime this year, which means the pro-EU people have got 6 more months to figure out a way to screw the British people on this deal. And John Kerry is out there openly saying there are ways Great Britain can reverse the Brexit results. They are out to kill this thing. They don't care what the voters want. They still have dreams of one planet, one government, one private central bank holding all humanity enslaved forever. We've got to take a break for commercials. We will be right back. Hello, hi, America. Welcome back to the show here, and we're talking about the Brexit and its aftermath. And what's really kind of interesting, everybody is responding to the yes vote in different ways, a lot of finger-pointing going on. The British National Party is now denying that they distributed leaflets in a West Yorkshire town where the Labour MP Joe Cox was killed, trying to link her murder to her support for helping Muslims get into the country. So everybody's backing off from some of that propaganda. Over in France, there are literally millions of French people in the streets protesting against the ruling class. All that's missing are the guillotines at this point and the tumbrils. Meanwhile, the U.S. continues to ratchet up tensions over in the South China Sea, rattling their sabers there. The U.S. is desperate to get a real hot war going any way they can, because they think if they can get into a real hot war with Russia or China, that we will all forget about the crimes and corruption and the spying on us and all the rest of it, and we'll throw the flag a snappy salute and we'll fling our money and our babies at the designated enemy. They're trying as hard as they can to get back to a new Cold War, if not a hot war. That's why the U.S. is sending missiles back into Turkey. That was a big bone of contention during the Cold War of the 1950s, 1960s, and it was the positioning of those missiles in Turkey's that led to the Soviet response of putting missiles in Cuba. Led to the Cuban Missile Crisis, and got us as close to a nuclear world war as anybody would ever want to be. But everybody's playing brinksmanship, and if they go over the brink, well, they've got all their bunkers. Mount Weather and the Greenbrier and all the rest of these places, they'll be fine. They'll come on out, you know, after 6 months or a year, and most of the rest of us will be gone, and they think that's just hunky-dory. Now, as I mentioned, Monday is Independence Day, and I hope everybody will take a moment away from the sporting events, the beer, the hot dogs, the fireworks, and we're going to have a spectacular one over Pearl Harbor, courtesy of the United States Navy, because RIMPAC is here. And every time RIMPAC is there, the Navy puts on a spectacular fireworks show, because they're showing off to everybody. But I hope you'll take a moment to read the Declaration of Independence, read my article about why it's still relevant today, and understand how far we have fallen from that brilliant vision of those founding fathers. And we put up a couple of articles at whatreallyhappened.com, links to Patrick Henry's Give Me Liberty speech. And a lot of people tend to view it as just bluster. The line, I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. And actually, there was a subtle economic message in there to King George III. And the message was simply, we can kill a lot of your people. You can kill a lot of ours, but we are not going back to being your economic slaves ever, ever, ever. There is no way you get that. All you can decide is how many people are going to die on which side. We also put up Common Sense by Thomas Paine, which is one of the most popular and widely read documents leading to the American Revolution, and you should look at that. And also Civil Disobedience by Henry David Thoreau. We put up another link on the fate of the signers of the Declaration. Because, like truth activists today, many of those signers of the Declaration had their lives ruined and destroyed for standing up to the oligarchy, to the Bank of England, and so forth. They did not all come out of the American Revolution in good shape. But they were willing to take that risk to accomplish something greater than themselves. Take a moment to remember who they all were and what they stood for and why they did why they did. Because that's what July 4th is really all about. How we came to be independent. And why we need to go back to being independent today. I know we've got a caller waiting on the line. I'm going to ask you to be patient until after this next commercial break, because we're almost at the commercial break. There's the music right there. We'll be right back. Hi, America. Welcome back to the show. We're going to grab some phone calls. Bob in Indiana, aloha. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Oh, it gets quiet all of a sudden. You mentioned Alaska yesterday.
Yes.
And my Russian wife says that Russia never did get the payment for it.
Imagine my shock. Are they going to move to repossess? That's going to be very tricky because Sarah Palin can see Russia from her front porch.
Well, the story is that the gold went on a ship and the ship headed for Russia and it never got there. So either the pirates got it or the bottom of the ocean got it. I don't know. Thanks for the show. I'll get offline and let you comment on it.
That's an interesting story. I would tend to think, given more recent activities involving gold by the U.S. government, is the ship never sailed at all in the first place. They just said, you know, bad weather, we're start pirates, you know, not our fault. All right, we're going to switch over to Lackey in Arizona. Aloha, welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Aloha, Mike, thanks.
You know, this thing with the Brexit, this thing hit me like a ton of bricks the other day, and I totally intend the pun with the bricks, because, you know, in this Brexit, they could totally start trading with Russia, et cetera, you know, the BRIC nations.
Yes.
And so that says no to stuff like the trade deal TTP, which probably includes, you know, GMO. They'll probably not have to deal with GMO if they didn't want to, or probably mandatory vaccines and immigration. You know, so this is a very good thing, and if it spreads, it could be awesome, you know, for the entire region, I would absolutely agree.
I mean, Bill Still had this absolutely brilliant observation the other day. He said, why do you need a free trade agreement? If you've got free trade, there doesn't need to be an agreement. And when you actually look at all these agreements that we're told are about free trade, they're actually very restrictive in trade. You will buy this product from over here. You will not buy that product. And the EU just went completely overboard with this stuff. What the U.S. goal is behind the Trans-Pacific Partnership and the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership is to lock the world back into an updated version of Bretton Woods, where the global economy is still centered on the U.S. dollar, and it is a giveaway to corporate authority, where corporations are now deemed legally superior to sovereign civil governments. So that if you're in a nation and you signed one of these treaties and you pass a law against a product that's proven to be harmful, the corporation that sells that product can actually ignore your law under the argument that you're impinging on their profits.
Right, and it's basically monopolizing the system. And if I could make one more point about immigration, Michael, I grew up in a public school system in Chicago, and this was right around the time, you know, I had started high school, and they hadn't implemented busing and desegregation, but toward my sophomore year, they actually started, you know, implementing this thing called desegregation through the busing program. And I kind of compare that to what's going on with this migration crisis now. Even as a youngster, I knew that it was not productive at all. There was something terribly wrong with it, and they were going about this fix in an entirely bad way, because it was creating more problems, more racial tension, actually, than the objective, so-called, was to solve racial issues, you know.
Well, yeah, they don't really want to solve the problem. They create the problem to get you to turn to them for a solution. But if they ever actually solved anything, then you wouldn't have a reason to be obeying the government. When the Soviet Union fell, Mikhail Gorbachev was joking, saying that they had just done the absolute worst thing to the U.S. government possible. They had deprived them of this very, very useful enemy that was used to scare us all into obedience and high taxes and the rest of it. And certainly in the years after the fall of the Soviet Union, the American people got very tired of the military-industrial complex. They wanted more of their tax money spent on them, the peace dividend. And, of course, the military-industrial complex said, no, we're not going to do that. One way or the other, we're going to get back to another Cold War and go back to soaking the people for all this money and for the life and limb of their children in these wars.
You know, it's a very interesting time, and something still tells me. A long time ago, before Obama's first term, I was having Thanksgiving dinner with a very close friend of mine, happens to be a Jewish attorney. And, so they have their New York Times type of thinking, and there was a couple other attorneys there at the dinner, and very nice time, but they were all going for Obama, you know, really the hope was going to be Obama if for the country. And I told him, actually, I thought he may be our last president because, you know, the things are going to continue so far downhill by the time that they can't legitimize even this guy saving the country. I thought, you know, there'd be another terrible terrorist attack and suspend the elections. But I think that's still because he's pretty cocky when he says Trump will not be president. So that either tells me that he's going to remain the president under some emergency or Hillary's just going to get the seat.
Yeah, well, I think it's more the latter. I mean, every president, when they're in office, they start looking for a way to get around that 25th Amendment. But they really can't, because even if the 25th Amendment were to be repealed today, it couldn't apply to Barack Obama because of the ex post facto prohibition. It would have to apply to the next president and from then on. I think it's more of the latter. And again, we keep hearing these very alarming rumors that Hillary's sending out a message that if she is not made president of the United States of America, she's going to start blowing the whistle on all the dirty deeds of the U.S. government for the last two decades and start ruining careers and possibly the government itself. And if you look at the way the corporate media and the White House and Debbie Wasserman Schultz and even the GOP leadership are all trying to put her in the White House, it sounds to me like, yeah, they're all afraid of what she could do if she doesn't get what she wants.
But if she gets in there, I don't think the people are going to tolerate it this time. I mean, they're going to continue to see wars, bailouts, and these types of things, and, of course, more gun control, possibly mandatory vaccinations. I think this could be the tipping point for the country. I don't think they realize what they have in store by, you know, keeping this thing going.
Well, I think if Hillary steals the White House, it will be the start of the dictatorship. She will not hesitate to do whatever it takes to get rid of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And beyond that, looking at some of her speeches in support of global government, I think she sees the presidency of the United States as a stepping stone to Empress of the Earth.
Well, the people, I think, have to then, at that point, that may be the tipping point with the American people. And possibly, like you always talk about, you know, all over the world, maybe simultaneously something can happen. And to me, that's the great awakening. You know, that's the Renaissance. That's even being saved, possibly, you know, from kind of religious metaphors. Just waking up and realizing, you know, even some of the things that Jesus was saying, they're just very simple. You know, do the things that I'm doing, like turning the money, the tables on the money changers, and you'll be saved, you know, that type of thing. So there's a good chance, I hope, that worldwide, and we might, you know, do it without firing a shot if everybody just refuses to go along with it, and, you know, the military turns around and comes home and really protects the borders or these types of things. But, you know, we wouldn't necessarily need all these border controls if the tyrants didn't exist in these third world countries either. You know, we can have a title of American or Mexican or what have you, especially down here in the Southwest. I'm very familiar with the problems of immigration and illegal immigration, these types of things. But they wouldn't have to come here looking for jobs if they had jobs and they had didn't have drug cartels and tyrants.
Yeah, but there's a piece you're missing.
There's
a piece you're missing. All of these tyrants in these other countries were put in there by covert U.S. coup d'etat, overthrow, regime change, whatever you want to call it. And, yes, it destroys their economy, and that's why they want to come here. Now they're playing that same game actually on our country because the money junkies are getting ready to simply abandon the United States as their base of operation. They're getting ready to declare some part of the earth the global capital, probably someplace around Jerusalem, and just let the United States sink into third world deterioration. I mean, we're well on our way. Thank you very much for the phone call. We're going to switch over to Mike in Maryland, who's been waiting very, very patiently. Aloha, and what is on your mind today?
Hey, thanks for taking my call. I'm here, I'm calling, well, I have a question, but first I'm here because I'm with DC911truth.org.
Yes.
That's DC911truth.org. And on Monday, the 4th of July, in Tacoma Park, Maryland, just outside of DC, we're going to participate in the 4th of July parade, and we're going to have our Truth March. And if anybody wants to help out, they can meet at Sue and Phil Wheaton's house at 7211 Spruce Avenue between 8 and 8:30, and because their streets close at 9. And the parade starts at 10. Last year we were between a Caribbean steel drum band and belly dancer, so it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, but, I imagine the belly dancer would be very, very interesting here. So that's dc911truth.org, and I am, in fact, putting that up at whatreallyhappened.com as we speak.
Okay, I appreciate it. Also, too, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Okay, well, yeah, and it has all the information there that you that you'll need. But I correct me if I'm wrong. I listen to so much talk radio. It's hard for me to keep track of where I hear information if it's true at all. But if I understand it correctly, is California mandating by law that all adults have to get vaccines? Is that true?
Yes. It hasn't passed yet, but it's going through the legislature right now. California has lost its collective mind. They're pushing this mandatory vaccination for adults. There'll be criminal penalties if you don't get your shot, even if it kills you. You know, better you die from the vaccine than we have to put you in jail, seems to be the attitude out there. They're getting ready to ban 80% lower receivers. If you want to build an AR-15, you're going to have to actually go through a gun background check just to get the parts. And California's just gone off the deep end with all this stuff.
Well, it's yeah, okay. So, because I knew that I know some states or some areas mandated first responders or healthcare workers to get the vaccines, and it might depend. It might have been California, somewhere else. But so basically, are they going to put clamping irons, or throw you in jail, or fine you?
I don't know. Maybe that's why they're giving AR-15s or M16s to the FDA. Where they'll come around to your house, point a gun at your head, and say, here's your needle. I mean, I can't think of another reason why the FDA would be handed all these military weapons.
I mean, that's just totally insane. I mean, California is a runaway state right now.
Well, basically, all of these governments are in chaos. They can't actually solve any of the real problems, so they're continuing to justify their taxation and their authority and their power by more and more bizarre laws and regulations. It's like the EU was doing, you know, with Kirby bananas and everything. They can't just stand up there at the Capitol building and say, we don't have a clue how to fix this mess, because then the people would say, all right, leave, go home. And so when in the absence of any real solutions to real problems, government's going to come up with all this hysteria and nonsense of, you know, marketing imaginary solutions to non-existent made-up problems.
It's crazy. Hey, great show as always. Thanks for plugging our website and our event coming up. And we always have future things going on. And, you know, I don't know if I'm doing any good handing out brochures and holding up signs, but I know if I don't do anything, the guilt would eat me alive.
Yeah, I understand that feeling. You're just compelled to try and make the world a better place. And you understand that just sending a monthly check to the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Baby Seals doesn't really do anything. And it's held up there for people to feel good about doing something without actually having to stand up in opposition to the corrupting influences in our society. Mike, thank you very much for the phone call. We're going to grab James in Oklahoma before the commercial break. James, aloha. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Yes. Can you hear me fine?
I can hear you just fine.
Okay. I heard that Hillary Clinton, a prophet, said that if she gets in, that the United States is toast.
I would agree, and I don't think it takes any psychic gift to see it.
another one is, I don't know if you heard of it yet, that Obama's going to have a November surprise that he's going to take over.
Hello?
He's going to take... Hello, I'm just, my mind is that he said he was going to make a deal with the Palestinians.
Well, that might be something that would look good as part of his legacy, but he's got to figure out a way of getting out of this mess with Hillary Clinton, because if she goes down, he goes down, and he's not happy about that one tiny bit.
Yeah, another one I heard was that... Hillary was going to, this a hearsay, that Obama was going to be her vice president.
I'm not sure. That's interesting. I can't imagine somebody who's been president agreeing to be vice president afterwards. And in any event, it would create a constitutional crisis because Obama's had his two terms that he's limited to by the Constitution. And I think under the 12th Amendment, he can't serve as vice president because he can't ascend to the presidency in the event something happens to Hillary. So it's a very fuzzy area. But I can't imagine him accepting that job. Most presidents, the presidency is the pinnacle, and they retire with dignity, and they go and write their memoirs and, you know, wait for 60 minutes to call him for an interview.
Yeah, but if he declare martial law, he can be president for the next 5 years.
Well, if he declares martial law, he's president for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yep, that was just some of the things I've been hearing, you know.
Well, there's a lot of stuff out there that's nonsense, and it's being put out there in an effort to try and make the independent media look kooky and wacko in the hope that it will draw people back to the corporate-controlled media. It's not working, but it's all they know how to do, so they're going to keep on doing it. James, thank you very much for the phone call. We're going to let you go. Coming up on a commercial break, but before we get there, up in Oregon, there's a man that has been accused in a triple murder, and he's an illegal immigrant. He's been deported 6 times back to Mexico since 2003, and every time he shows up at the border, they let him on through again, and now there is blood on the hands of everybody that supports this open borders agenda. We'll be right back after these few words. America, welcome back to our show. We're going to go right back to the phones. John in Barbados, aloha. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Aloha, Michael. I have some very disturbing news. Apparently, Putin has issued an order to the military that if they come under any sort of danger, they should target all coalition forces.
I would want to be very careful about that. I have no doubt that Putin would issue an order to his forces that if they're fired upon, that they should return fire. But to launch a broad attack against all coalition forces, I'd want to double check that one.
According to what I've been reading, if their military comes under any sort of danger, then they're supposed to target. They've been ordered to target the coalition. So there we go.
Where did you read this?
Sputnik News.
Okay. Would you email me that URL? I want to take a look because there's been so much Russia-bashing propaganda in the media lately. We need to be very, very careful, even with Sputnik News, even with Pravda, even with Russia Today, because the only way the U.S. is going to be able to start a war with Russia and China with any hope of winning it is to make it look like Russia and China somehow are at fault. It's like when Roosevelt spent all of 1941 goading the Japanese into attacking Pearl Harbor and then acting like it was a big surprise. Now, again, it makes sense that the Russian military would be told that if they come under fire, that they should return fire. That's legitimate. But in order to just broadly launch an attack against all coalition forces, that I'm having a real hard time thinking that came from Putin.
Yeah, well, it's not that they launch a broad attack against all coalition forces, that they should retaliate against any endangerment of Russian forces in Syria.
Okay, well, that makes a lot more sense. You know, that the way you originally phrased it, it sounded like it was to simply say, go and hit all coalition forces, period. But obviously, an authorization to return fire when attacked makes a lot of sense, especially when Putin is looking at what happened in Iraq the other day when the U.S. forces were trying to prevent the Iraqi F-16s from bombing this ISIS convoy that the U.S. refused to bomb because they claimed the weather was bad. But they were still in there protecting the convoy from the F-16s, at which point Iraq went in with helicopters and did the job. So Putin is probably realizing that you know, there could be more shoot downs of Russian jets, and he's basically telling his forces, yeah, you can protect yourselves. I mean, you know, maintain the safety of your command, and that's a very reasonable thing to do.
Yeah, it's just another ramp up in this saber rattling, I think, but it could be very, very dangerous.
It could be very dangerous, but we need to be really accurate here because we know the propagandists are looking for some way to claim that Russia has provoked all of this or China's provoked all of this, and we know that is simply not true. This is all taking place on the borders of Russia, the borders of China, the Middle East. Nobody is over here in the, you know, floating around the borders of the North American continent with warships and warplanes and stuff. Do you have anything more, John? We're going to have to keep you...
Yes.
Okay, all right. Yes, stay on the line. We got to do a minute for a station identification, then we'll be right back. Aloha, America. Welcome back to our show. Hour number two. The phone lines are open, 800-313-9443, and we're talking with John in Barbados. John, what else do you have for us today?
Well, I have a solution for this nonsense within the two major parties in Britain. The process is quite simple. These MPs go before the local constituency party committees and are selected, having been interviewed. So what I propose is, we know that the majority of people voted to Brexit, so when these people who are remain candidates come before the selection committee, they're deselected, simple as that, not even given a chance to stand at the next election. They're thrown out.
Well, we're seeing a lot of the same thing in our party machines, who are basically trying to engineer candidates for us. I mean, look how hard they tried to keep Donald Trump from, winning the nomination. And Donald Trump had a quote on the TV earlier today. He feels like he's running against two parties, the Democrats and the Republicans.
Well, I'm with Nigel Farage on this one. He said, nothing on this earth will persuade me to vote for Hillary Clinton.
He came on out and he said he thinks Hillary Clinton's a crook, and he's right. But we actually know she's a crook. She's in violation of Title 18, Section 793, and that renders her ineligible for holding any government office, including the presidency. And that, I think, says a lot about the state of our nation today, where the political machine is literally trying to force a criminal on us as president who is not legally eligible. And they were also doing it with Ted Cruz, although for a completely different reason.
Anyway, I was looking at another story on Sputnik News about the F-35, and they were saying how it would be possible to use this machine in any forthcoming war against Russia or China. And my comment was, yes, well, use it as a sacrificial lamb.
Yeah, use it as a target drone. I mean, the only thing they've been able to do with the F-35 successfully so far is show it off in air shows. But even if they get everything working, it's so bloated and overweight. Its actual performance is very, very poor. It's overly dependent on its missile systems and its whiz-bang electronics, which was the same mistake they made with the original Phantom F4, where they figured all wars are going to be fought with these wonder weapons, these missiles, and the original F4 did not even have an onboard cannon. And as a result, the kill ratio during Vietnam fell to 3-1, whereas before it had been 12-1. And so they started Top Gun and everything, which was all good about training dogfighters, because the conventional wisdom is if you survive your first 5 dogfights, you're going to survive the war. And so the purpose of Top Gun is to literally put pilots through the first 5 dogfights where they're not going to die. And they come on out of this as experienced fighters. But at the same time, they added a gun to the Phantom F4 in an underbelly pod. So they realized the mistake they made. And now they're doing it all over again with the F-35. This so-called glass cockpit vision system still doesn't work. The networking among F-35s, they're getting false targets. One target will appear to be 4. They can't get everything to line on up. The software for the cannon isn't going to be ready till 2019. Can't fly in the water, can't fly in the fog, can't fly near lightning. Those helmet fire control systems, which have to be custom built for every single pilot, and those are hundreds of thousands of dollars each, they don't work yet. War's going to be over by the time they get the F-35 actually working.
I've got one last piece of information that I want to impart, and that is Finland is proposing to join NATO. And Russia said to Finland, well, our troops are 1,500 kilometers from your border. Where do you think they will be if you join NATO?
We need to be very, very cautious about, you know, provocative statements. Because that doesn't sound like Putin. That doesn't sound like Putin to me. It sounds like somebody's trying to put words in Putin's mouth. Because he's trying to tamp this thing down.
Oh, absolutely. But as he said before, you know, if NATO builds its forces on the Russian border, Russia will match them.
Well, that's also a very reasonable thing to do. But again, as we reported earlier in the show, Putin is extending the hand of negotiation to NATO and saying, let's sit down and sort of talk this over about what's really going on here. And I'm sure Putin understands that NATO is basically being driven by the U.S. agenda, which is to start a new war in the hope it's somehow going to fix this debt-based economic Ponzi scheme, which it isn't.
Well, I mean, the other thing that I noted was I think it was Finney Cunningham, an independent sort of reporter who publishes articles in several outlets, and he said that what was happening at the moment is that even Germany now is looking at what's happening with this Brexit and on top of Russian sanctions. What's it going to do to their business and their exports? You know, this is a real blow to the German economy.
It absolutely is, and the German economy is under stress because they've been propping up the rest of the EU along with Great Britain, and now Great Britain is leaving. Germany's absorbed all these refugees who are now basically feasting on the social safety nets there. Taxpayer expense, and Merkel at least is still taking this stern attitude about sanctions against Russia, and we're not going to do business with an independent Great Britain, and obviously she's thinking in terms of this globalist agenda and not what's best for her own country. She is not going to survive her next re-election absent world-shaking massive over-the-top election fraud.
Well, I think that seems to be now par for the course, bearing in mind Scotland, the Brexit, and what's happening in the American primaries.
I think probably the smart thing to do now is instead of looking for all the cases where an election is fraudulent, we can save a lot of time and effort just counting the ones that are absolutely honest and verifiable. And I can't find any.
Of course, Austria, the election commission has ordered a rerun of the last presidential election because of all the fraud that took place.
Yes,
and we know how it took place through those postal ballots.
Absolutely, and I would hope to see this as a beginning of a cry by the people of the world that we demand an honest, accurate, verifiable election system, or we're not going to listen to any government that claims authority over us on the basis of unverifiable claims coming out of those electronic machines. And we need to basically have a zero-tolerance policy for election fraud. And I'm glad to see all these lawsuits launching here in the U.S. There's going to be tremendous political pressure against them because that belief in an honest, fair election system is the only thing holding our current government in power. Everybody is disgusted with government. They've lost all trust and faith. The only thing gluing it together is the number of people who believe that somehow or other they voted for what's happening to them, and therefore they share the guilt. And they absolutely don't. At this point, I think it's reasonable to basically say all of these elections are frauds. It's just a theater pageant governments go through to convince you are somehow in control of what's going on, when in point of fact you're being reduced to the level of serfs.
Well, what I'm hearing now from the Austrians is that when they do hold this election and they're counting the votes, there's going to be more observers than counters to make sure there's no fraud going on.
I think that's an excellent idea, and I'm glad Austria set that policy. We're going to take a moment here to welcome our on-air affiliates back to the program. We're talking about election fraud. We're talking about Austria ordering a complete redo of their recent presidential election because of all the problems in their elections. And, John, thank you for the phone call. I'm going to let you go here because I got a bunch of stories before the lovely Lady Claire joins us on the air. And I'm going to start with this one. Remember earlier in the show I said governments that can't actually solve a real problem will come up with something totally silly and symbolic in order to justify their funding, their pay, their positions and everything. Up in Sweden, where the refugee sex assault epidemic is out of control, the Swedish police have come up with a solution. They're giving out free wristbands to Swedish women that say, "Don't touch me." I'm not even sure what language they're in. If it's in Swedish, it's not going to really be very much good on people who are speaking Farsi or Arabic or Urdu. But that's it. They, you know, they don't want to fight the immigration agenda, the globalist agenda, the New World Order agenda. They can't stop the rape epidemic, but they're going to hand out wristbands. Ooh, gee, that'll solve it. Those rapists will come leaping out of that alley. They'll see that wristband, and they'll wither away like a vampire in the sunlight. Now, here's a story. It actually happened earlier in the week, but I felt it was necessary to talk about this. There was, apparently on June 16th, there was an end-of-the-year class party at the William Tatum Elementary School in Collingswood, where they had treats. And there was a third grader who was talking about the brownies. And what he meant were these little chocolate blocks that were among the treats. And somebody else in the class said, "You're being racist," and they called the police on this third grader and the family. The kid was talking about the snacks, not people, but somebody heard the word brownie. "Oh, he's being racist. And it reminds me of the time when David Howard was forced to resign from the Washington, D.C. civic government for using the word niggardly. Now, his co-workers, who are part of that class of people whose entire self-valuation is based on always finding things to be offended by, screamed he was a racist. He used the N-word. But the word niggardly means cheap or stingy. It has nothing to do with skin color. And Howard used the word during a meeting on getting the budget under control. So Howard lost his job not because he was racist, but because his co-workers were morons with weak vocabularies, which makes them perfect fodder for the political correctness agenda. Now, fortunately, sanity eventually prevailed, and Howard was rehired by Mayor Anthony Williams. But that's how out of control this whole PC thing has gone. They're finding offense where none actually exists. A third grader says, "Oh, great brownies," and somebody says, "You're being racist." There'll never be a remake of the movie Moby Dick, because there's going to be some idiot out there screaming, "How come it has to be a white whale?" And as a matter of fact, the last movie telling the story, the whale wasn't white. Did you notice that? It's amazing. Alrighty, now then, by the way, there's a film you ought to catch. It's running around cable right now. And it's not a new movie. It's called The Insider. It's Russell Crowe and Al Pacino. And it's telling the true story about this tobacco company executive who questioned the health of the product and was fired and then smeared and abused and ultimately decided he needed to get the information out in the public. And the fight to get it aired on 60 Minutes, which at the time was still under the control of Don Hewitt, that we all remember, admitted on video editing the Jennifer Flowers interview to help Bill Clinton. So you could see what the Al Pacino character was up against. But it's directed by Michael Mann, who's a good director, and it's a true story. And it's floating around on HBO right now, so set your little DVR to grab it. It's worth watching. Because Claire and I were watching it the other night, and Claire kept looking at it and saying, yeah, that's what we went through. With one difference. In the movie, the wife leaves the guy. And in real life, Claire has stayed fast and true and my best friend all the time. So there's a story here that's coming on out over at Government Slaves where apparently there was this year-long Manhattan cocaine sting that during the final arrest nailed a Fox producer, Fox News producer, an executive with Chipotle, an associate at Merrill Lynch, Wall Street accountants, Cushman and Wakefield broker, and a blogger for the Huffington Post were all caught up in this sting. We're going to grab a phone call. AJ in Texas, aloha, welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Hey, Mike, how are you? I'm a long-time listener, first-time caller. I just had a couple questions for you. I was wondering, number one, I had recently seen the video that Alex Jones came out with in the 2000s about Bohemian Grove.
Yes.
And I know a lot of times you talk about how a lot of the information out there is out there to poison the well. And I was just kind of wondering what your thoughts are on the occult and the elite and how they come together.
Well, we know that the elites like to have their little getaways where they don't have to deal with us hoi polloi. And Bohemian Grove is one of them. Jeff Epstein's little island was another, and so forth and so on. And I sort of look at Bohemian Grove as kind of like their version of the Renaissance Pleasure Fair, where they get to put on strange costumes and pretend to be somebody that they aren't. And one of the reasons I think so is I found a photo, or actually a whole bunch of photos, of some of the earliest Bohemian Grove ceremonies. And you look closely, you see stage lights. You see an auto transformer dimmer board. It's a theater pageant. Now, I'm sure that a lot of the people at the Grove are having little private discussions conducive to their business, just as they do at the Council on Foreign Relations, at the Bilderbergers, and so forth. But I think the occult overtones of Bohemian Grove, it's more of a play-acting thing, and I wouldn't take it all that seriously.
Gotcha. Gotcha. And then my second question is actually, what do you think about the rumors that Trump is vetting Christie right now? Do you think that he's going to be a viable pick for VP, and how do you think that's going to affect people voting for him?
Well, I think it would be a bad choice. I think Newt Gingrich would be a worse choice, and we know Sheldon Adelson is offering hundreds of millions of dollars to Donald Trump's campaign to pick Newt as a vice president. But Newt is the ultimate insider. He's part of the system. If Trump is dumb enough to name him as his vice presidential running mate, they're going to shoot him right off the inauguration platform to get Newt into that Oval Office. Christie carries a lot of political baggage. I don't see Christie as a good selection for vice president, but as you said right at the beginning, these are rumors that are being put on out there. And they're being put on out there probably to try and damage Donald Trump. We're not really going to know until the convention. I don't think Donald Trump is really seriously going to be thinking about the VP until he knows he's survived the attempts to oust him at the GOP convention.
Awesome. Yeah, I agree. And, yeah, that's it for me, man. I just want to let you know, man, we really appreciate everything you do. I'm listening from Austin, Texas right now, and you got a lot of support out here. And, man, I think you're probably one of the better representatives for this movement that's out there. So thanks for everything you do, man. We appreciate it.
Well, thank you very much for the kind words, and thank you very much for the phone call. We're going to let you go here. Getting on back to the news, interesting little story coming out of Raw Story. Apparently there's an ex-Secret Service agent is now under suspicion for stealing $700,000 worth of bitcoins from a Secret Service account 3 months after the agency was urged to block his access. In other words, they were warned 3 months ahead of the crime that this guy should not be allowed to have access. The money had come from the takedown of the Silk Road system. So more proof that when a government goes corrupt, it goes all corrupt. Absolutely all the way corrupt. All right, we're coming up here on another commercial break. When we come on back from this, a little bit about guns, gun rights, gun activism, and heading on up to the top of the hour when the lovely Lady Claire will be joining us. So we'll be right back. Hello, hi, America. Welcome back to the show. And before we go to the phones here, I'm looking at this report on the We Hate Donald Trump News Network saying that Loretta Lynch is now saying she will accept whatever recommendation she receives from the FBI regarding indictments of Hillary Clinton, which tells us they're going to drop the blame for no indictments on FBI Director Comey on this particular situation. Okay, Bob in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. Aloha. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Good afternoon, Michael.
What can I do for you?
I've noticed many times Hillary Clinton, when they bring up these things, she says, it's old news and can't we move on? Well, I noticed they convicted a 90-some-year-old guy in Germany of being a guard at a prison camp. So I guess the simple answer is no.
No, we're not going to move on from that. And she said move on so many times that, you know, people are ready to start buying stock in the moving van companies. But the reality is when Donald Trump made his comments about Hillary's past, he made it all current events, whether it's the Clinton dead bodies list, the epic of Clinton's mess, which is a roundup of some but not all of the known Clinton scandals. And, of course, the big one was Hillary Clinton, in fact, spying, selling secrets when she was Secretary of State using her weak email server to deliver the goods and her so-called charitable foundation to collect and launder the payments. I mean, it's an absolutely perfect spy system. She doesn't have to physically steal files the way Jonathan Pollard did. She didn't have to go out and put chalk marks on mailboxes like Aldrich Ames did. She didn't have to take bags of documents and tape them underneath a bridge at a suburban park the way Robert Hansen did. It's an absolutely perfect system, and it's legitimate to ask, in light of the 1996 Chinagate scandal, which involved the transfer of sensitive technology to China in exchange for money pouring into Bill Clinton's reelection campaign, it's legitimate to ask this question. And what's really amazing is that nobody in the corporate media or government wants to even touch this question, even to try and ridicule the idea.
Ain't that the truth? But with her misdeeds, let's move on. But for the rest of us, well, no.
No, I'm not moving on. I don't consider
it. Thank you, Michael.
All right. Thank you very much here. Okay, now then, we're going to get on to the gun rights here. And let's see. I need to take a quick look at who it is who's attacking my server. Every time I talk about Hillary, it comes on in. Okay, so let's just do that. Now, interesting little story. And this is being reported out of CBS12.com. Where there was this grandmother at her home, and her home was broken into by three burglars. And she had a gun on the premises. She pointed the gun at one of the burglars, and they took off, running. She defended her home with the gun. The police were not there. In fact, the police apparently haven't yet to actually find the would-be burglars. And that's why we all should have, are supposed to have, a right to keep and bear arms. We have a right to defend ourselves against criminals. And common sense says we have a right to the same caliber and type of weapons criminals do. And some of those criminals are getting those weapons from the U.S. government's Fast and Furious program. One of them turned out to be used in the Paris attacks. Now, there was another shooting incident at a nightclub down in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And it didn't turn into a debacle with lots and lots of bodies and everybody waiting 3 hours for SWAT to show up, because one of the patrons of the nightclub, with a valid concealed weapons permit, shot the perpetrator, brought him down. And, of course, the media, we don't want to run stories about people with legally owned firearms thwarting crimes. I mean, how are we going to push a gun grabber agenda if people think that they can defend themselves from criminals with guns? It's far better for them to be raped and killed by the criminals, you know, than to let the ordinary people have guns. Another article that came out of one of the prepper websites. 5 gun parts to buy before they are banned. And some of them are silly. Apparently, the Clinton assault weapons ban, we got to take a break for commercials. We'll be right back. And aloha, America. Welcome back to the show here. And before we get back to the guns here, a story that just crossed my desk here. Apparently, the Obama administration yesterday asked a federal court to delay until October 2018 the release of 14,000 pages of emails from aides to former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. They're broadcasting the fact that there is a cover-up. And what's really interesting for those of us who study history, in the months leading up to Richard Nixon's re-election, they'd already known about the Watergate break-in. The Washington Post was already covering the story. And everybody inside the government was saying, oh, it's nonsense, it's kooky, it's conspiracy theory. And then we had to go through the whole thing of Richard Nixon's fall from power and the subsequent cover-up of what was really going on by Gerald Ford. Do we have to go through that again? I don't think we ought to. We know there's a cover-up. Something is being covered up that is illegal, or at the very least, a reason not to vote for Hillary Clinton. And we should take this intervention. In fact, let's call it what it is, obstruction of justice by the Obama administration as evidence why we should not be voting for Hillary Clinton. Now, Hillary Clinton, who, by the way, is still out there saying she's going to attack Iran. When she's the president, she is going to turn Iran into a giant glowing green glass parking lot and send in the Marines to paint the lines. Now, she's also a gun grabber. She wants to bring back the assault weapon ban that had been passed during her husband's term in office, and it's been basically pushed back by the Supreme Court saying there is that Second Amendment thing you've got to deal with. But the target of the gun grabbers right now, and it's why we're having all these stage shootings like Orlando, where they're finally admitting nobody actually got shot until the SWAT team and police went in. They want to target adjustable stocks because they think this is somehow the difference between a hunting and sporting weapon and one that's used for mass shootings. Now, adjustable stocks do not make the gun any more deadly. It's clearly something that's been thought up by somebody who doesn't actually know how to use guns. And that's one of the hallmarks of the gun grabbers. We saw that with that individual who wrote about how firing a .223 AR-15 was traumatizing and left him with, traumatic stress syndrome, and it sounded like a cannon, and he was so terrified by the noise. And then it was followed up by all these videos of these very young children being very carefully and properly taught by their parents how to fire an AR-15, and they all thought it was great fun. Now, for some reason, the government now wants to ban threaded barrels. In other words, barrels that have a thread at the front end to which you would attach a muzzle brake to reduce recoil or a flash suppressor, and it doesn't make the weapon any more deadly. It's something that was thought up of by somebody who doesn't really know about weapons. Of course, they're continuing their war on high capacity magazines. You don't need 30 rounds to hunt deer. Well, they didn't give us the Second Amendment because the deer were coming. Now let's look at a situation of a home invasion. Let's take that grandmother. She had 3 criminals breaking into her home. If they all had weapons with 10-round magazines, why should she not have a 30-round magazine to keep herself alive and safe? And let's be honest, the criminals are going to have 30-round magazines. All of these restrictions do not impact the criminals or terrorists. And again, the United States Supreme Court ruled in United States versus Miller The Second Amendment grants to the American people the same weapons held by the uniformed forces. If police have a 30-round magazine, you're allowed to have one as well. One of the sillier aspects was the attempt to ban pistol grips, because a pistol grip makes a weapon an assault weapon, because you can shoot from the hip, and we know that's true because we've been watching all these Rambo movies. Now, some weapons like the AR-15, a pistol grip is integral. You can't take it off. And it may be that once again they're targeting that AR-15. They're obsessed with the AR-15. They were calling the weapon in Orlando an AR-15, and actually it wasn't. But that's what they're after. And now apparently they're going to declare war on the 80% lower receivers. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with what I'm talking about, under BATF rules and regulations, in modern, complicated, multi-part guns, there is always one component that is deemed legally the gun that must have a serial number and a paper trail from manufacturer to customer. And for the AR-15, that's the lower receiver. But the BATF rules say you can make your own for your own personal use. And it doesn't have to have a serial number, and it doesn't have to have any kind of a registration. And this exception is in there for people who are doing research and development on how to make these weapons better, more effective, more reliable. California is now trying to set the stage where somebody who wants to buy a blank metal casting of a lower receiver will have to go through a gun check and register this blank metal casting as a weapon. So they're coming after those 80% receivers. So if you're into building that kind of weaponry, it might be time to stock up, because they're going to be 10 to 20 times as much on the black market, which there will be a healthy version of, because that's all the ban's going to do. Set up a new smuggling opportunity and rake in the dough. Now, over in Tennessee, they have a bill that's been introduced by Representative John Wendel, and it's House Bill 2389, and it prohibits Tennessee law enforcement officers from enforcing provisions of any international law or treaties that limit gun rights, as specified in Article 1, Section 26 of the Tennessee State Constitution. So Tennessee is taking a stand for gun rights. And they're saying the treaties do not apply. Now, if you're a car enthusiast, and I sort of am, not as much as I used to be. When I was a kid, I did a lot of gearhead type stuff. I helped my mother restore a 1952 MGTC. And that was her baby. And she did the body and upholstery, and I did the engine and drivetrain. And the first time she drove that around the block, I think was one of the happiest times I'd ever seen her in her life. So I've had grease under my fingernails. Like everybody else, we've been looking at the Teslas as a really well-done idea of an electric car. They have joined the self-driving car trend. And I want to emphasize the safety record is still superior to manually driven cars and even the safety records on other self-driving cars. But they have had a fatal accident. And it was one of those circumstances where the lighting was just right, the coloring of the other vehicle was just right, and neither the self-driving system or the driver, who was actually a former Navy SEAL, saw what was going to happen before it did. Now, me, I want to drive my own cars. The former host of Top Gear, Jeremy Clarkson, and I share that in common. We don't like traction control. There was only ever one vehicle with a traction control that I actually felt comfortable in, and that was in a, I think it was called a Canyon pickup by Chevy. But every other traction control, I always felt a disconnect between what I was doing and the road. Like it was always on the verge of slipping out. Now, I understand that's not what's really happening, but that's what it felt like to me. But this rush to self-driving cars, it's something they're probably going to mandate down the road. But Google is in the self-driving car development phase as well. Their cars have had some problems. And one of the reasons their cars are having problems is their cars are programmed to drive as perfect drivers. And they get into trouble when they go out in the real world and they're surrounded by imperfect drivers. People who are tired, intoxicated, in the grip of road rage, frustrated, distracted by their cell phones, and that's where they get into trouble. And I truly think that driving really is bordering on the edge of a true artificial intelligence system. And I don't think the technology is robust there. It's getting very good, and maybe if every car was automated, they would all mesh together quite well. But they're still having issues on that. Okay, a new report has come on out that 5,300 Civic U.S. water systems are basically putting out levels of lead, toxin, and other components that are outside the legal limits, literally poisoning millions. We're looking at 18 million Americans are living in communities where the water systems have illegal amounts of contaminants. Flint was just the tip of the iceberg. Aaron Brockovich is out there saying they've found thousands and thousands of communities. And if you're worried about your water, you can get a water test kit for about $25 on eBay. And we did that here. We tested our water. We're very lucky in Hawaii. The only test it failed was the water hardness, which we kind of understand because we're sucking our water out from inside an extinct volcano. But if you're worried about your water, you do need to get it tested. Now, lawmakers, 61 members of Congress, have sent a letter to the Environmental Protection Agency saying that their current standards for lead in drinking water are actually too high, given what is currently known about the damage lead causes to brains. And they're saying it has to be even lower than it is. The current EPA limit is 15 parts per billion, and this letter is saying it has to be brought down to 10 parts per billion, which is in line with the World Health Organization's guidelines for lead contamination. We're having our emergency sirens go off in the distance because it's the first of the month. I hope they warned all those people visiting from RIMPAC so they don't all man their guns thinking they're being attacked or something. Now, one of the reasons I think people are turning against their political structures is the sense of arrogance, disinterest, callousness that seems to keep on coming from on high. And apparently over in Mississippi, in the town of Richland, there was a lady, Nicole Nichols, and had a real problem. She's got children with type 1 diabetes, and they qualify under the Medicaid CHIPS coverage, but they're not getting the money. And so she wrote to the Mississippi House of Representatives saying, we qualify for the program, the taxes have been paid, we need the help. And she got a message from Mississippi State Representative Jeffrey Gusey, I hope I'm saying that correctly, a Republican from Ocean Springs, saying, look, just buy the money, buy the medicine out of the supplies with the money you earn. Just pay for it yourself. And that's kind of a weird thing. We have a government that wants us all to be dependent on the government to control us, and yet when we actually have a need, they say, go out now, deal with it yourself. Good example of that is the Affordable Care Act, which is not affordable. And as of last count, 1.6 million Americans have now dropped out of the Obamacare health insurance policies this year. They're going to pay cash for their medical care. They're going to pay the IRS fine. They can't afford those sky-high health insurance premiums, and because of the sky-high deductibles, they're not getting anything for the money anyway. Obamacare is a complete and utter failure. Now, over in the remaining nations of the European Union, they're starting to move on banning glyphosate because of the growing body of evidence that it is, in fact, carcinogenic. And Monsanto is having a hissy fit. as is usual, like they're doing here in the U.S. We've got to ban GMO labeling. We've got to protect our profits, and we don't care if the product is making people sick, because then our brethren over there in the hospitals and pharmaceutical companies will be making money. But there is the beginning of a pushback, and there ought to be. And one thing that we have lost in this country, and we can blame it on the computer revolution, is the idea of product liability. Now, in the good old days, back in the days of steam-powered terminals and kerosene keyboards, there was such a thing as product liability. If you sold a product that harmed people, they could sue you. Then we had the dawn of the small computer, home computer industry, and they succeeded in getting Congress to say, okay, we're going to indemnify you from civil liability. Because you're a brand new budding industry, you have to be protected. Well, personal computers are a major, major industry now. They don't need the protection, but they still have it. And other industries have now come on board, including the vaccine industry, which was indemnified by a provision put into the Homeland Security Act. And if you are harmed by a vaccine, you are not allowed to sue the vaccine maker. You have to go to the vaccine injury court, which if they decide you have been harmed by the vaccine, will pay you some kind of compensation that comes not from the vaccine companies, but from taxpayers. You're seeing how this nation continues to descend into absolute fascism. Now, we've talked on this show before about the problem of space junk. There's a lot of stuff up there in orbit. Bits and pieces left over from the early space program, one of the gloves from Gemini. And it is a problem. There have been incidents where the shuttles were hit by small debris, space stations having to dodge things, and people are saying, how are we going to fix this? And I've got my own way of doing it. But the Japanese Space Agency has come up with an idea, and they're going to be testing it very soon. And it basically involves a very long wire that is going to magnetically interact with the space junk to slow it down enough to reenter the Earth's atmosphere, which sounds like a good idea if they can get it to work, and I think the Japanese can. And immediately the first thing the U.S. comes on out and said, well, Japan is building an anti-satellite weapon for military purposes. I don't think so. Anyway, we'll be right back. Aloha, America. Welcome back to the show. And we're now getting word Governor Jerry Brown has just signed 6 new gun control measures out there in California that will require people to turn in high-capacity magazines and require background checks just for ammunition sales. Now, California already has some of the strictest gun laws in the nation. And they're not going to let you grandfather your 30-round magazines out there. And background checks for ammunition, I mean, that really is absurd. Good reason to set up a home loading bench. Now, little bit of good news. Brown vetoed 5 other bills, including the requirement to register homemade firearms, which is going to be a boon to black powder enthusiasts, such as yours truly. And he vetoed a measure that would require the reporting of lost or stolen weapons to authorities. I'm not even sure why anybody put that out there, because I think any responsible gun owner is immediately going to report a lost or stolen weapon to the authorities. Not that they're going to get it back, but that's the responsible thing to do. We are also receiving word that finally, tomorrow, Saturday, Hillary Clinton will be having her first meeting with the FBI regarding the email server. So they're at least going through the motions, and Hillary will no longer be able to say, well, the FBI hasn't even talked to me. Now, over in Fukushima, now, as you know, the current head of TEPCO came on out and apologized for the lies his predecessor told when the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant melted down. And they still have a huge cleanup problem. If you look at that site through Google Earth, you're going to see all these giant temporary water storage bags, whatever you want to call them, just piled all over the place. And they've run out of room, and they're having to dump some of it into the ocean. Well, using a new technology that is able to image through the reactor using muons, they've determined that there is a large amount of melted nuclear fuel remaining at the bottom of reactor number 2. And they do need to find out where this stuff is. Once it's melted down, it could be spontaneously going through fission, producing huge amounts of heat. And something's producing heat down there. That's why they have to keep pouring the cooling water on there. The real danger is if it's actually melted through the bottom of the building into the soil underneath, and it's working its way down, because when it hits the water table, which is really close there on the edge of the ocean, you could start seeing radioactive geysers showing up. They really messed this one up. They really messed it up. And I know the anti-nuclear people are out there saying, see, we told you. But I am convinced that these technologies can be handled safely. The problem is when the money junkies start cutting corners. All right, we got to take a break for station identification. Back for hour number 3 and the lovely Lady Claire after these few words. Aloha, America. Welcome back to our show, hour number 3. And for those of you watching on the BAM user streaming feed, this gorgeous creature sitting behind me is the lovely Lady Claire, who likes to join us on hour number 3 on Friday with her unique perspective on the world. But before we turn the microphone over to her, we do have one more phone call. Alex in Florida, aloha. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Not much, Michael. Hey,
oh, well, thank you for the call.
Hello.
Hello, you're on the air.
Yes, Michael. You have once said, or more than once, that there is a law that protects the citizens of the United States from being taxed for war expenses. What is there a law?
No. You're confusing that. I said there's what's called a principle of international law called odious debt. And the principle of odious debt is that the people of a nation are responsible only for certain debts incurred by their government. If the government borrows money for infrastructure like roads and schools and hospitals, the people are legitimately on the hook to repay that. But certain kinds of government borrowing, such as for war, to repression of the people, borrowing money to give to other countries, when that government collapses, that debt is considered not part of the responsibility of the people, and it's called odious debt. Okay?
Okay. Hey, all right, thank you. Now, you just mentioned something about Hillary Clinton's email, but I was late turning on your show today. I just got in from out of town. What did you just say? They made an announcement about something or something?
Yeah, basically she's going to be talking to the FBI tomorrow when we're all distracted with our barbecues and everything. Again, they're going to go through the motions, but I'm not expecting the FBI to actually come up with anything, no matter what she's really done, because the FBI has been the protector of the Clintons going all the way back to the murder of White House Deputy Counsel Vincent Foster, and I don't expect them to change their behavior now. Okay?
Yeah, what a shame. I guess we'll have to file this in the JFK and 9/11 conspiracy files.
Well, you know, too many of these conspiracies do turn out to be true, and interesting, getting some issues from BAM user. All right, well, Alex, thank you very much for the phone call.
Okay,
we're going to let you go. Bye-bye. And Claire, what's your first story?
This is something from last year, but I think it's important to look at, especially with both conventions so close. On a television interview on MSNBC, one of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter made the statement that they would shut down the GOP convention if they could. Now, this was last year with Melissa Harry Paris' show, which is no longer on MSNBC. And it's very interesting because we are hearing bits and pieces about problems with security in Cleveland. And I'm having to wonder if this might be part of a larger program, and you addressed it a little bit earlier in your show. What if there is some kind of a plan, if you will, to use chaos at the conventions as a means for Obama to suspend the Constitution and Bill of Rights and initial martial law.
Well, the problem with that is the violence would literally have to be nationwide.
Yeah.
Violence at a convention, and the political conventions are known to bring out the protesters, going all the way back to Chicago, the Democratic Convention back then in the 60s. You know, a riot around a convention center is not justification for declaring a national emergency and suspending the Constitution. But it could be, certainly be part of a plan of trying, again, to hijack the nomination process. Now, I don't think there's going to be an issue around the Democratic Convention because Hillary has successfully stolen the primaries. Bernie Sanders, people are going to be protesting that fact. But I'm still convinced that there's going to be a last-ditch Hail Mary pass by the GOP leadership to find some way to get Donald Trump out of there and put in somebody that they know Hillary Clinton can easily beat. And violence and chaos. I mean, all the violence and chaos we know is coming from these rent-a-mob groups. Soros' funding move on. But every time the violence happens, they're all saying, oh, well, it's Donald Trump's fault because he's saying these things about immigration. And if he would just shut up and go along with the globalist agenda, there wouldn't have to be all this violence. Classic blame the victim. So, yeah, I think we're probably going to have a tumultuous GOP convention.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I would also like to hop on to something that I think is very ironic at the end of a week where people are getting ready for a three-day holiday. The U.S. has informed Moscow of new sanctions against Russian entities. And they're imposing sanctions on a number of the country's entities over breaching the Iran, North Korea, and Syria Non-Proliferation Act. And that was a statement made to a U.S., rather by a U.S. State Department spokesperson today. And the measure will remain in effect for 2 years.
Well, I mean, these sanctions have already crippled the economies of Europe, Venezuela, Canada, the fracking industry, and everything. So, sure, let's just keep on doing the same thing over and over again and hoping for a different outcome, which is Albert Einstein's definition of insanity.
Of insanity, I know.
All right, we got to take a minute here to welcome our on-air affiliates back to the warm embrace of the Republic Broadcasting Network. And we're basically talking with the Lady Claire about current events. And what is your next current event?
Well, I'd like to look at this a little bit more deeply, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Because what the State Department and the U.S. government has done has been to just even more firmly join China and Russia at the hip, both economically and militarily.
Well, I understand from a certain point of view, wanting to treat Russia and China as a unit makes sense because it's the ruble and the yuan that is the threat
to the U.S.
the dollar,
hegemonic
domination of
the
dollar.
Right.
And going after just one does not remove the threat of the other. The insane part here is thinking that the U.S., even with their NATO allies, can actually win a conventional war against Russia and China, given the currently demonstrated superiority of the Russian and Chinese weapons.
Yeah.
And that means opening the door to an actual nuclear exchange, and nobody's going to win that except the bankers.
No, absolutely not. And speaking of banks, Italy has been granted extraordinary 150 billion euros bank bailout program to prevent panic and runs on deposits. Now, there were rumors on Monday, and Merkel shot them down the next day, and it got louder and louder, and
and then it happened.
And then it happened, and, you know, very quietly, and apparently this is an extraordinary crisis rule for state aid that was invoked. And Italy's banks are not doing well. But the problem
is, none of Europe's banks are doing well.
Yeah, the financial contagion, Mike, isn't going to stop with Italy.
No, it isn't. Yeah, it really isn't. And, you know, even the IMF came on out and finally admitted debt-based monetary systems are unstable. They basically came on out and validated the 11th marble. They're going to these measures to just to sort of tick things along and keep it from collapsing completely. But it's a fool's game. It's going to collapse anyway. We've got way too many people who are at the tops of these banks and tops of these governments whose thinking entirely is, I just need to hold it together until I'm out of office, and then if it blows up after that, it's somebody else's problem. And that's very short-sighted thinking, and it's not really dealing with the problem, which is, as the IMF is now admitting, private central banks that issue all the public currency as a loan at interest are inherently unstable.
And the IMF, speaking of which, has characterized Deutsche Bank as the riskiest financial institution in the world. And that's saying something. And it was one of the banks that did not make it through the Federal Reserve stress test, an exercise measuring how 33 banks would fare in the event of another financial crisis.
No, it didn't. And, of course, Deutsche, I think they've lost something like 3% of their stock value this week alone.
Well, what it did, what this report did, was to send the bank's stock Thursday to its lowest price in more than 30 years as the shares were already reeling from the Brexit. So this is, you know, this is going to continue. And, of course, we have a bank holiday on Monday here in the U.S., but I think I'm going to want to pay very close attention to what the European banks are doing on Monday.
Absolutely. We definitely want to do that.
Yeah.
But again, all of these banks are now linked with each other in this era of globalism, plus the derivatives exposure.
Mm-hmm.
And the good news is the entire system could come down at once and open up literally a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to restart the national economies on the basis of government issues the currency and it does not accrue interest to anybody. Because we know from American history that system works.
Yeah.
One of the major reasons we fought the revolution was to break free of the predatory practices of the Bank of England.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is not taught in our schools anymore, and it hasn't been taught in our public schools for 100 years, because of concern that the smart kids are going to stand up and say, hey, that Federal Reserve is exactly the same system that we fought the war to break free of in the first place.
Right, right.
Well, that kid's got ADHD. Give him some pills.
Yes.
You know, zone him out so he doesn't think these ungood thoughts.
Yes. I'd sort of like to go over now to the TSA, the Tourism Suppression Agency.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, they beat a disabled woman bloody after she became confused and afraid at a checkpoint. And while she was undergoing, she was coming back from treatment for a brain tumor, for God's sake. And Hannah Cohen set off the metal detector at a security checkpoint at the Memphis airport, and she was led away for additional screening, and she didn't know what was happening. The lady's paralyzed, she's blind in one eye, and she's got hearing difficulties. And her mother, Shirley, tried to tell the agents that her 19-year-old is partially deaf, blind in one eye, paralyzed, and easily confused. But the police kept her away. And when the kid tried to run away, agents violently took her to the ground, bleeding everywhere.
Well, there's a couple of things you need to know about the TSA.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, as we learned on our recent trip to Kuwait, there's some very sick people in there.
There are some very interesting
that like
of
to
God's
steal
children.
Panties.
Yes.
And let's face it, it's not like people actually get up and say, I want to have a job going through people's dirty laundry.
Mm-hmm.
The people working for the TSA are the ones who fail to get jobs over at the hamburger joints.
Yep.
Okay. And they are, by and large, morons who do not see what's before them and understand what it is, whether it's a computer or a camera or what have you. And I'll give you a good example. This goes back to when I was working as a visual effects supervisor on the Lost TV series. And on no less than three separate occasions, we got seriously whacked by TSA. Now, here on Oahu, we do not have a film lab that can handle motion picture film. Good reason to shoot digital, as I tried to suggest, and they wouldn't listen to me about that one. So you can't get a one-light work print for daily. So the exposed negative from the camera gets flown to California. They develop it, do a one-light work print, throw it onto DVDs, and send it back to us. So our dailies actually come in 2 days later, which is a terrible inconvenience. On three separate occasions, despite labels all over the can saying exposed film, do not open, the TSA opened exposed rolls of film and destroyed days of shooting work. Three separate times. And we kept going over there and saying, this is what we're doing. And had all the labels for the production company and all the rest of it, and there was no reason. And somebody just said, gosh, I wonder what's in this round can with all the tape and the do not expose to lights. I'll bet it's Osama bin Laden's record collection. And, you know, and of course, my personal experience up in Seattle, a TSA guy dropped a very expensive high-end laptop and destroyed it.
Yeah.
I didn't get an apology, let alone a replacement laptop.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if anybody in government is wondering why the TSA is so loathed,
yeah,
this is a reason. They're not putting on a good face of being any kind of a benefit to the American people,
mm-hmm.
and certainly they have been a curse on our tourism here in Hawaii.
And one of the things that's evolved from this event,
yes,
is that the mother is going to sue TSA in the daughter's behalf.
Good.
And, you know, if there is any government agency other than the IRS that probably needs to be sued out of existence, it is the TSA. I hope the compensation is intense if the jury finds for the plaintiffs. And again, TSA, I would like to see you sued out of existence in a peaceful, quiet way.
Well, they'll probably send over a boxcar of purple rubber gloves or something. You know, say, here's our settlement. Have that. You know.
Right.
Here's a box of all the stuff we stole from passengers.
Oh, yes, and it appears up on eBay, right?
There's some panties in here and a couple of Swiss Army knives. Yes. You know. It really is absurd. And a reminder here, in all of its years of abusing the American people and ruining our tourist industry, TSA has never actually caught a real terrorist. And every time the Department of Homeland Security runs a testing exercise,
mm-hmm.
90% of the pretend bombs and guns get through the security screening onto the airplane.
Yeah.
Because the TSA is too busy stealing panties to sniff at when they're whacking off late at night.
Very strange. Something else that was in the news dump today that I found extremely interesting.
Yes.
The U.S. and Iceland have signed a joint defense agreement. The U.S. Department of Defense and Ministry of Foreign Affairs has signed an agreement regarding the continued American presence in Iceland.
Yes.
And it was also said that the agreement was ratified under the concept that the U.S. would defend Iceland from aggression.
Well, basically, if you look at a globe,
yes,
where Iceland sits, it's mm-hmm. in a very commanding position for those North Atlantic sea lanes of communication.
Oh, yeah.
And going back to Tom Clancy, he wrote a book called Red Storm Rising about mm-hmm. a new world war between the West and Russia,
mm-hmm.
although in his book, Russia did start the war, as we know in our case, the U.S. is starting the mm-hmm. war. But he talks about the importance of Iceland
yeah.
and why it is a key strategic item, just like Leon Sue yesterday was talking about Hawaii's strategic location here,
mm-hmm.
Commanding the Eastern Pacific.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is not a trivial exercise. From the U.S. point of view, having control of Iceland, being able to use it as a base to project power from, is basically to guarantee control over the North Atlantic.
And, you know, it's again another symptom of an upcoming war with Russia.
Yes.
I mean, there are no two ways to slice it. This is what I'm seeing. Now, Mike, if there were some fighters that were pre-positioned, how long would it take them to get to the more European part of Russia?
With aerial refueling,
yeah.
Well, it depends on what part of Europe, but you're talking
yeah.
about six, mm-hmm. 8, maybe 10 hours.
Okay.
But you're not going to have fighters on Iceland to attack Europe with. The fighters on Iceland are going to be to protect Iceland from air attack.
Okay.
But you can station bombers there. There
yeah.
are 5 usable airfields there right. if your aircraft are rough field capable.
Mm-hmm.
Old Keflavik is still there.
Yes.
And so, yeah, it would be mostly long-range bombers, Spirits,
mm-hmm.
Lancers,
mm-hmm.
And that ilk.
Right. I just thought the timing was a little too cute.
Well, it's inevitable at this point, given
mm-hmm.
this continued push,
yeah.
you know, for a new world war.
Yeah. Apparently, going over to that wonderful dark side company, Monsanto. Monsanto is going to be sued over claims that their weed killer Roundup gave 30 people cancer. And according to Yolanda Mendoza, who had been a user of Monsanto's Roundup weed killer, nearly killed her. And what she wound up with was non-Hodgkin's lymphoma.
Which is serious.
Which is very serious. During her 5-month battle with the disease, her children were only allowed to visit once a week because she was in such a terrible state. And there were moments when she thought she wasn't going to make it through, but she said her kids helped her keep going. And she said in an interview, the most difficult part was not being able to be there for them. Now, she's had intense chemo. Her cancer is in remission. But she is now fighting a battle against the product that she said made her sick. And it's the popular weed killer Roundup. And she used it in a backpack sprayer once a week on her 1-acre property. and she'd strap it on and walk around spraying. And I am hoping that this lawsuit is done well and that she and the rest of the plaintiffs do get a lot of money from Monsanto, because the evilness in this company is monstrous.
And again, I want to refer you back to that movie that's running on HBO right now called The Insider, Russell Crowe, Al Pacino, because the tactics used by Big Tobacco to protect their carcinogenic, addictive product are exactly the same tactics we see from Monsanto protecting glyphosate and GMO, or the vaccine makers protecting their product. It's business as usual for the American corporate mindset. We've got to take a break for commercials. We'll be back in just 3 minutes with the lovely Lady Claire.
Would you?
Aloha, America. Welcome back to our show here. And before we go back to the lovely Lady Claire, we have a phone call from Kathy in Massachusetts. Aloha, Kathy. Welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Hi, Mike. I apologize for if I don't have the best reception. I have actually washed my phone in the washer. I saved it with rice, and I'm using the headset. I'm not kidding you. It's amazing.
I can hear you just fine. I can hear you
fine. Yeah. This is my question. I was speaking with someone today, and they told me that, you know, I'm in Boston, so I've got all these Ivy League people around me. They said if it wasn't for Monsanto, the third world would have already basically died off. It was only Monsanto and their pesticides that allowed the third world people to have life, you know, life. And I said, you know, I called BS on it. In my down home Texas, kind of, you know, I lived a lot of years in Texas and Louisiana. But what is this? Is there any source documentation that I can, you know, give next week to, you know, to win this argument?
Well, what you ought to be searching for on Google is the fact that the actual yields from these GMO crops have turned out to be lower than the natural varieties. The GMO plants are less resistant to environmental stress, which is what led to that BT cotton disaster in India that resulted in all those suicides. And they're now discovering that this so-called golden rice that was supposed to be the salvation of the third world is turning out to be seriously nutritionally deficient as well. And I think Monsanto is out there remembering what happened to DDT, which was another big product they put out there saying it's saving the third world and everything, and it only took it 3 years to almost destroy the food chain completely before it was finally banned. Mm-hmm. So there's information out there. You're just going to have to do a little bit of Google search and dig it out for yourself.
Okay, so just research the golden rice.
Yes.
And that would be a good place to start. Thank you kindly, and you guys have a great weekend.
You
Same
too.
Same to you. Happy Independence Day, and we're going to go back to the lovely Lady Claire now.
Well, apparently, and, you know, just when you think that the U.S. government cannot get more enabling of Israel, the U.S. government surprises me yet again. And the U.S. is the only country to oppose U.N. holding Israel accountable for war crimes, and this comes to us out of Mondelweiss. It was the only country in the world to oppose a resolution calling for Israel to be held accountable for war crimes at the 29th regular session of the UN Human Rights Commission, UNHRC, which went from 15 June and it will terminate this Sunday. And how this can be done by a government that talks about peace, freedom, human rights. The U.S. voted against ensuring accountability and justice for all violation of international laws in the occupied territories. 41 nations voted for the measure, including Germany, France, Japan, Brazil, China, and more. And five nations abstained, which included India, which is buying a lot of weaponry from Israel these days. And it's an interesting thing to me. Apparently, with the U.S. military bombing innocent civilians all over the world and the common acceptance of Israeli money through AIPAC, members of the U.S. government have no problem seeing Palestinians as irrelevant or collateral damage for the Israeli government, deserving of no human rights whatsoever. You know.
Yeah, we've got way too many people in this country, in this government, rather, for whom Israel is their top priority, and Hillary is only going to be worse about it.
Yep.
And yes, Donald Trump is trying to walk a fine line between Israel and Palestine, but Hillary has made no secret of the fact that as far as she's concerned, Israel should just kill all the Palestinians and grab all that land, and she's owned by Israel, and she has been for many, many decades.
Yeah, Israel and Wall Street.
Okay. What else do we have?
Apparently, DHS and the First Responders Group have created a way to transmit encrypted live video and data using broadcast television. It's called data casting. The FRG is part of the DHS. And when broadcast television transitioned from analog to digital broadcast transmissions, it created the opportunity to allocate the television spectrum in new ways. And data casting takes advantage of a portion of the public broadcasting station's bandwidth normally used for public TV.
Okay, well, this actually makes sense. It's kind of analogous to when AM radio transitioned to FM, and the FM bandwidth allowed for what were called subcarriers. That's what all the pager systems were using and everything. We got to take another break for commercials. We'll be right back. And hello, America. Welcome back to the show. And we're looking at this story about how the government is now setting up communication channels buried inside digital broadcast TV. And basically what the article is talking about is in the event of some kind of a crisis, a riot, a revolution, all of the communication systems we are dependent on will be shut off, which would be an inconvenience to the police and the authorities unless they have already set up other communication systems we do not have access to. And I think one reason that they're setting up this whole new system on the digital broadcast channels, and by the way, the very, very first police radios were at the low end of the AM broadcast band. I remember as a kid, you could hear the Concord police by turning the AM radio all the way down to the bottom. So they're always grabbing on to public man space. But I think the other reason they want these new communication systems is because of how many of these scanners are out there in the hands of people. Including trunking scanners, which can listen to the new encrypted police communication systems. So basically, just like the government set up its own private internet that's not connected to the regular internet, they're setting up a whole new private communications infrastructure so that they can continue to communicate while they pull the plug on all of your tablets and smartphones and the rest of it.
Absolutely. Thank you for clarifying that. And it's happened before with BART, the Barrier Rapid Transit Authority, shut down all cell phones to prevent a demonstration. And this is back in 2011.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Apple has a patent now for a system in which it will be possible to send a signal to the iPhone to disable its cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And it's being sold as protection of intellectual property or property rights so that when you go to a concert, and you want to take a picture of your band to show to your friends, you won't be able to. You know, if you want a picture, you will buy one. And I think that's going to backfire because when you go to a concert to see your favorite band, you're waiting in line outside for a long time. You've paid a huge amount of money for the tickets. You want to be able to take a picture that proves to your friends you were really there. And I think if they start blocking the ability of audience members to just take a snapshot or even a selfie with their favorite band in the background, that a lot of people are just going to say it's not worth going to those concerts anymore.
Yeah, absolutely. The next thing I'd like to look at, the CIA press conference looks like a Saturday Night Live skit as official refuses to answer questions on stolen arms. And I mean, This is
a press conference. Oh. I don't have time for questions.
Right. You know, and here is the president who promised us the most transparent administration in history.
What he meant is our lives will be totally transparent to the government.
Yes.
He didn't say it was the government.
There's where I'm at. That's my
where
problem.
That's a mistake. We're
okay.
All transparent. They look at us naked at the airport scanners.
Yep.
You know, we're the ones that have to be transparent so that the government doesn't feel too threatened and scared of us.
And the CIA has been operating a covert weapons program in Syria, buying Kalashnikov assault rifles, mortars, and rocket-propelled grenades in Eastern Europe for delivery to the moderate Syrian rebels.
And then somehow the weapons always get from the moderates to the ISIS and Al-Qaeda.
Yeah.
And the U.S. excuse is, oh, they were stolen. Really, honest, they were stolen. Somebody left the key in the ignition.
Yep.
And that truck full of all these weapons left the moderate rebels that we love and support, and you should as well, and they went over to the bad guys at ISIS and Al-Qaeda.
Yeah.
And I think somebody put up a video of CIA Director Brenner literally running away from a camera
mm-hmm.
that was asking about, you know, were these weapons really stolen, or are you still
yeah.
supporting
yeah.
ISIS and Al-Qaeda and
well,
the rest of it?
Well, this CIA spokesperson just refused to answer reporters' questions. And the question I have is, why are these people even bothering to attend a press conference when they know that they're going to be lied to and stonewalled?
There was even a comment made by a State Department spokes drone
mm-hmm.
saying that, yes, it's acceptable for us to lie to the corporate media for the sake of diplomacy. I mean, this government is admitting they're lying to everybody about everything. We
yep.
should just stop listening.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the corporate media ought to stop showing up at those press conferences,
yeah.
you know, but they show up because they want to get a ride on Air Force One and,
yeah.
and get a coffee mug to prove that they did it.
Then I'd like to go over to the drone program.
Okay.
And Obama did announce the numbers of people allegedly killed by U.S. drones, but there is a catch. And, yes, he did this today, but they're only announcing the numbers of civilians killed by illegal U.S. drone strikes, but only in countries where the world's biggest military hasn't officially declared war. Several news outlets reported, citing leaks from U.S. officials, that the number is expected to be listed at 100. Well, I saw the press release today. It's 116. It's only a fraction of those estimated by investigative journalists and human rights groups who track violations of international law. And
well, I mean, look at how they're rigging yeah. the unemployment numbers. Do you really think they're going to be coming clean on how many innocent people are being blown to bloody shreds by your tax dollars?
No,
I don't
not at
think
all.
So.
And what this reminds me of, and this is a terribly harsh analogy, but it feels very real to me. This is somewhat akin to touching up an X-ray picture when someone has cancer and making it appear cosmetically as not that big of a deal. But Mike, in my world, all extrajudicial assassinations, which is what these are a big deal and have absolutely no place in American jurisprudence. Period. End of discussion. And the only thing that these murders are going to do is create more willingness in more people where we're bombing to commit jihad against Americans or American interests. And, Mike, I have to wonder, do you think that was the plan kind of all along? Perpetual drone bombings is going to create a perpetual drone war.
Well, I think the perpetual drone bombings was there to basically increase the degree of chaos,
mm-hmm.
The degree of terror. I think Obama is using the drone strikes the way Hitler used the V-1 buzz bomb and
mm-hmm.
the V-2 ballistic missile to terrorize populations into pressuring their government to capitulate to U.S. demands.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is, the U.S. is murdering innocent people in nations we are not at war with. This is a war crime.
Yeah.
And I don't believe this 106 number one tiny, tiny bit.
No. I would say a conservative but closer number would be in the thousands or maybe even tens of thousands.
I would go with that last one.
Yeah. And what concerns me is it appears to me that this totally out-of-control government has lost its ability to rationally and reasonably negotiate in good faith and create win-win environments. You know, when a kid's got a hammer, everything becomes a nail, which has to be hammered.
Our system doesn't want win-win solutions anymore. They
yeah.
want we win, you lose. We get your wealth to keep our private central bankers happy.
Mm-hmm.
You lose your wealth, so your private central bankers will go to bed, well, not hungry, but crying.
Yeah.
And there is no good faith because the U.S. has gone back on its promises and treaties so many times, nobody trusts anything that they say anymore.
Mm-hmm.
We've all seen the polls about how the American people no longer trust the U.S. government. Do you think it's any different in terms of international relations? Foreign governments know they cannot trust anything the U.S. government says. They're routinely violating treaties,
mm-hmm.
going back on their word.
Yeah. And it's very frustrating out there.
It really is. What's next on your list?
Next on my list, Charles Koch's plot to hijack U.S. universities and spread his radical free market propaganda. And
ooh,
apparently,
the free market.
Oh, free market when it's done in a moral way is not a bad thing. Not done in a moral way, in a way that really hurts people, that's a bad thing. And apparently what this guy is doing is spending millions to build his own ideological institutions. And he's funded colleges and universities and bent them in his direction, often funding free market academic centers. Mostly through his personal foundation, he gave $108 million to 366 colleges and universities from 2005 to 2014, and more since then.
Well, it sounds to me like this may be the beginning of the pushback to the so-called free trade agreements.
Yeah.
And as Bill still says, if you've got free trade, you don't need an agreement. And we have discovered with Trans-Pacific Partnership, TTIP,
mm-hmm. yeah.
the EU itself, free trade is actually a cover for very, very restricted trade.
Yes.
Obviously, the opposite of that is a free market where prices find their own natural level through supply and demand, and there's mm-hmm. none of this tinkering and stuff going on. So given a choice between imposed free trade agreements that favor corporations and a free market, which in a way returns power to the people because we get to buy the products that we choose to buy rather than being told we must have them, I think free market is the beginning of the pushback to the free trade oligarchs.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that that's going to be, as you said, I think there's going to be a huge, huge pushback against that.
Well, the Brexit was the beginning of it.
Mm-hmm.
The Brexit
yep.
was the beginning. What's right. next, my dear?
Next, we have some feedback on the Benghazi victims relative to Clinton's plea to move on. Now, she may have gotten through the House Republican Benghazi investigation, but her desire to put the issue to bed came across to some as remarkably tone-deaf. And Secretary of State Clinton said, I'll leave it to others to characterize the report, but I think it's pretty clear it's time to move on. She said this week in Denver.
The report only came out 4 days ago, by
yeah,
the way.
Yeah. And these remarks.
Oh, that's so yesterday.
Yeah, right. So 20 minutes ago. These remarks earned the ire of Dorothy Woods, widow of former Navy SEAL Tyrone Woods, who was one of the four Americans who got killed. And what she said, and this is very authentic, and I understand this, nobody in government can tell me how I should feel. She has no right, nor does anyone in government have the right, to tell me it's time to move on. They're not in my shoes. For Woods and many Republicans, the report did not change her view of what happened or who was to blame. And she said, I place the blame on the sentiment, on this attitude in the upper level of government that says, hey, you know what? I'm just going to lie about this, gloss it over, because I want to protect what I look like and I'm thinking about my next job.
Well, there was that interesting comment that we got from a caller earlier in the show
mm-hmm.
Where we have Israel and Germany are still out there desperate to find more Nazis to put on show trials. And they're picking up these 90-year-old accountants and bookkeepers and
mm-hmm.
radio operators and
yep.
saying, you were part of the horror. Never forgive, never forget.
Yep.
And Hillary's perfectly on board with that. You know, this guy fed the guard dogs at Auschwitz. You know, string him up. But for Hillary Clinton, all the things she's done, even if it only came out a few days ago,
mm-hmm.
that's yesterday.
Yeah.
And no, we're not going to move on. We're
nope.
not going to move on. We're dealing with a government that has become entirely corrupt and criminal.
Yes.
And we dare not ignore it any longer.
No, we ignore it at our peril.
Yes, that
and
too.
And we can't move on because there could have been something done to have spared the lives of our ambassador and those other people there, and it wasn't.
Well, it's even more fundamental than that.
Yeah.
If we ignore this behavior and move on,
mm-hmm.
we're moving on to more of that same behavior.
Yeah. Yeah, it gives the government the get-out-of-jail-free card, if you will, to do this behavior, this kind of behavior, over and over again. And I would like to be a fly on the wall tomorrow, Mike, when the FBI is interviewing Hillary Clinton. Wonder what that's going to be like, but do you expect that it's just going to be more of the same?
Is your chair comfortable, Madam Secretary? Want some more coffee? Have a croissant. Okay?
So that's going to be the whole enchilada?
That's probably going to be it. Like I said, the FBI has been the Clintons' protectors
mm-hmm.
since the murder of White House Deputy Counsel Vincent Foster.
Yeah.
I would love to be pleasantly surprised,
yeah,
but I don't think so, because if I am correct,
mm-hmm.
and Hillary was selling secrets to foreign governments through that weak email server and collecting and laundering payments through her charitable foundation. That's a scandal that could bring the entire government crashing down. Mm-hmm. And that means everybody inside the government, including Hillary's worst enemies, are going to be working to protect her, to protect their own paychecks and their lofty positions.
Yeah, and it's the big lie that cannot be exposed.
That's right.
In essence, yeah. And we get exposure to the little lies every so often, but the big, hairy, fat ones, that's the ones that everyone tries to keep covered up.
What happened to John F. Kennedy? What happened to Robert F. Kennedy? What really happened to Teddy Kennedy?
Yep.
9/11?
Yep.
So forth and so on.
Yeah, the big lies.
The big lies.
Yeah.
What have you got next for us, my dear?
Well, it's also about Hillary Clinton.
Oh, good. Let's bash her some more.
Yeah, well, this is factual, dear. When it's factual.
So much the better.
It's not a bash.
So much the better.
Apparently.
Let me get my Hillary Clinton temple over here with the nutcracker and the Hillary Clinton toilet paper.
Okay.
Wait till you see what we're coming up with next.
Oh, dear. I'm almost terrified to ask.
You already know.
Oh, yes. Never mind. Apparently, Clinton sought secret info on the EU bailout plans as her son-in-law's doomed hedge fund gambled on Greece. The hedge fund manager, Mark Mesvinsky, has friends in high places, and when he bet on a Greek economic recovery, but even the keen interest of his mother-in-law, the then Secretary of State Clinton, wasn't enough to spare him and his investors from financial tragedy.
He basically cratered, but because he's married to Chelsea Clinton, everybody just kind of said, oh, well, we'll find some way to dump the losses on the taxpayer.
Bulletproof.
Because we always do that.
Yes. And in 2012, Mesvinsky, the husband of Chelsea Clinton, created a $325 million basket of offshore funds under the Eagle Vale Partners banner through a special arrangement with investment bank Goldman Sachs. The funds have lost tens of millions of dollars, predicting that bailouts of the Greek banking system would pump the value of the economy's distressed bonds.
And you know what's really amazing?
Yeah.
Okay, to prove that we're actually smarter than people like Mark, we knew that the bailout money going into Greece was going to do a 180 and go right back out of Greece into the pockets of the European Central Bank and the IMF. And the fact that he didn't know that was what was going on tells you that these are not very bright people.
No.
They're just people with advantages, people with political connections, and actually they're capable of some incredible stupidity.
Yeah. Apparently one fund exclusively dedicated to Greek debt suffered a near total loss. And Clinton stepped down as Secretary of State in 2013 so she could run for president. But newly released emails from 2012 show that she and Clinton Foundation consultant Sidney Blumenthal, where have I heard that name before, shared classified information about how the German leadership viewed the prospects for a Greek bailout. Clinton also shared protected State Department information about Greek bonds with her husband at the same time.
That's a Title 18 violation right there.
We've
got to take a break for a commercial.
Yep.
We'll be back with the last segment. Aloha, America. Welcome back to our show on this Pauhana Friday here, our last segment. And again, a quick reminder, Monday's show will be a repeat, and we're going to be allowing our overworked and grossly underpaid technical staff and our talk show hosts to have the day off. So there'll be a repeat broadcast. And Claire and I would like to wish you all have a relaxing, happy weekend. And again, as I said earlier in the show, please take a moment to remember just why we celebrate this day and what it meant and what the intention of the founding fathers who signed that Declaration of Independence really was.
And knowing what the dangers were ahead of them after having signed it.
And a lot of them did not do very well out of that revolution.
No.
Just like the truth seekers of today. They destroyed their own lives, but it was a sacrifice they felt was necessary for the greater good of the nation as a whole. So read that declaration. Read the article on how the Declaration is actually relevant today. It's not just some fuzzy thing in history, like all the statists are trying to convince you that it is. And remember that there's a reason we called it Independence Day and not Freedom Day or Birthday or we kicked the British butt out of our homes day. It's because the day we became independent and able to make our own choices, what we buy, who we bought it from, who we sold to, and so forth and so on. So, Claire, have you got anything to add to that?
I just hope that everyone kind of reaches out to family and friends and talks about this as something being important. Don't overwhelm them with information, but little bits here and there, so that they start doing their own reality checks about what is going on now and how far we have fallen from the Democratic Republic, which was founded or began to be founded by that Declaration of Independence, and where we are right now and what we have to do in the most peaceful, logical way to get our country back.
Okay, and one final note here, always safety first. If you are living in an area where you're still actually allowed to have fireworks, I know those are fewer and fewer.
Yep.
They're banning them in all the western states where they've got that brush fire danger. But if you are in an area where fireworks are allowed, handle them safely.
Mm-hmm.
Do not do anything dumb or reckless with them. Have fire extinguisher or a pail of water nearby.
Yeah.
Because the goal of this holiday is to have fun and not provide more fodder for those who would like to ban fireworks entirely from the American people, right alongside guns. They don't want to trust us with anything that can go bang. Alrighty.
Absolutely not.
All right. So we're into the holiday weekend here. And again, happy Independence Day. And join us back here next Tuesday live on the Republic Broadcasting Network. And again, need to be very concerned and watchful about a possible false flag on the 4th, although I am betting the next one is actually going to be at those Olympics, which are coming up. They've been used as a target of false flag attacks before.
Yes.
And we all know how desperate our government is to scare us back into obedience with some kind of new boogeyman out there, which is why they're pushing terror, 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 terror. All right, there's the music. Time for Claire and I to get out of here and get something useful done with the rest of the day. We'll be back Tuesday here on the Republic Broadcasting Network. Until then, have a good weekend. Share what you know with everybody that you know. Thanks to everybody who's been supporting WhatReallyHappened.com, and Aloha America.